Okay, good morning, and first of all, I would like to take this opportunity to thank Cloud Lightning team to invite me and HCL to present in this conference. So Dieter has given a supercomputing level picture, you know, so what I want you to do is actually zoom in right into a node in one of the supercomputers. So I'm going to give you a very nodal picture. So the topic I'm going to speak about, I'm sorry for the title, it's too big, but I wanted it to be very accurate. Okay, so it's optimization of data parallel applications on multi-core and many-core platforms for performance and energy. Okay, and I'm going to talk about what are the new challenges right now when we are using these platforms, and we have novel solutions already, which are innovated at HCL. Okay, so what has this got to do with heterogeneity? So these solutions are for homogeneous environments, but actually these solutions are heterogeneous workload distributions. So so solutions are actually heterogeneous. Okay, the outline of the talk, I'm going to motivate the case for what are the novel solutions, which are the load imbalancing solutions. So first of all, I'm going to talk about the new complexities in the latest multi-core and mini-core CPUs. Okay, so, and then I'm going to show you, illustrate these complexities using HPC kernels and applications. I'm going to take two kernels, matrix multiplication, Fourier transform. These are the, what are known as the most well-known core kernels used in HPC. And I'm going to use a real-life application, a weather forecasting application used in Europe and mainly developed in Poland. Okay. So I'm going to compare and contrast the performance and energy profiles. I'm going to show you how drastically they have changed over the years, just because of these new complex platforms. So what's happened because of these complex chips is the traditional load balancing data partitioning algorithms face serious challenges in the sense that they don't give you optimal solutions any longer. So you need to have new novel methods and novel algorithms, data partitioning algorithms. Okay, so then I'm going to talk about the novel solutions, which are the load imbalancing solutions. So now I think we are entering an era of load imbalancing instead of load balanced solutions. I may not have enough time to present the algorithms, but I'm going to give the problem statements, and I'm going to give overview of the algorithms, how the algorithms determine the heterogeneous workload distributions on homogeneous environments, and then I will conclude the talk. Okay, so the first thing is take the latest multi-cores and many-core platforms. They are quite complex, and they have tighter integration, and this has very profound implications for your applications. So I'm going to show you what these new complexities are. So if you take a look at this, this is the Haswell Xeon CPU, and the specification is shown there. The number of cores is 12. It's a server CPU, Haswell server CPU. The important thing to notice is these 12 cores share a last level cache, okay, and that is probably the biggest bottleneck in this machine. And it has a TDP of 120 watts. I'm showing you the TDP here because I'm going to talk about energy consumption in this talk. So it was launched in quarter 3, 2014. Now we have Skylake, we have Broadwell, we have Skylake. As you can see, what I want to show you is I don't want to actually bore you with the gory internal details of these chips, too complex. Important thing to notice here is that they are actually cramming more and more cores in a chip for power efficiency reasons, to get more performance. So what's happening is all these cores are actually sharing, contending for critical resources on the die, on the chip. And in this case, it's last level cache. So we are right now, we are 28 cores. And I think IBM Power CPUs have more than like 50 cores. So this is Intel Xeon Phi coprocessor. This is the competing accelerator solution to NVIDIA's GPUs. I'm showing you here nice corner and nice landing offerings. I'm showing you the 3120P is quite old, but this is what we have in our lab, and we have experimented with it. It has 57 cores. As you can see, the cores have increased. Now we have 72 cores. Now the remarkable thing is they've added more cores, they've increased the frequency, but they have actually reduced the power. So there must have been some real innovations that have gone into night landing to make this happen. But what I want to show you here is that they are again cramming more and more cores. And as you can see in the picture here, there is no loss level cache. Okay? The L2 cache is actually private, it's per core, but it's kept coherent by locally distributed tag directory. Most of the other elements in the picture, like the memory controllers, are actually interconnected by bi-directional ring. They're interleaved in the ring, and so this globally distributed tag directory is actually distributed along the ring. You know, and this ring is actually the bottleneck here, instead of the last level cache, which I showed in the previous picture. Okay, so on an L2 miss, what happens is the tag directories in the ring are actually queried, and the miss is not taken care of, then it goes to the memory controller and then to the memory. So what happens is, if you have a multi-threaded application using all the cores, a very compute-intensive application, you know, it's going to create lots of traffic. Okay, if you haven't optimized it because of the L2 cache misses. So in this case, as you can see, again tight integration, again too much contention for shared resources. In this case, which is the ring. Okay, now, so I'll summarize the complexities. So we have tighter integration of many cores to deliver superior performance and energy efficiency, but there are several new challenges and new complexities, which are resource contention. So in the case of Haswell, you have last level cache, which is the bottleneck, on-chip interconnect. In the case of many core Xeon Phi processors, you have the bidirectional ring. Then you have the challenge of non-uniform memory access. Of course, there's also a challenge of portability of cores, which I won't talk about in this talk. But what's happened because of this contention, serious contention, because of the tighter integration, is that the behaviors or the profiles of multi-threaded HPC applications have shown dramatic changes. Okay, and because of these changes, we have serious challenges to model and algorithm designers. So when we speak of model designers, it's performance model, energy model designers, and algorithm designers could be performance and energy sequential algorithms, parallel algorithms. So they face very formidable challenges because of these complex chips. So I'm going to show you now some examples illustrating how this tighter integration has created the dramatic changes in the profiles. Okay, so I'm going to compare and contrast the performance and energy profiles of HPC kernels and applications. Pick two kernels, very core kernels, matrix multiplication, you must have heard of DGEM, MKL-DGEM, MKL-FFT, which is Fourier transform, and a weather forecasting application, it's called MKData. It's a well-known application used in Europe for weather forecasting and other simulations. Okay, so this is the performance profile of OpenBLAS DGEM. OpenBLAS is a very highly optimized open source matrix multiplication library. Okay, and as you can see here, I've used Intel Haswell 12 cores. It's actually two processors we have, so we have 24 cores. Now what I'm showing you here is a picture, just picture unicore processors before the multicore scale. Okay, now this is how your application would, profile would look like. It's very smooth. Okay. The problem size here is the size of the matrix. So you can multiply two square matrices. Okay, the problem size is n square. Okay. And I've used just one core to simulate the situation before the multicore scale. Okay. As you can see, the speed which is on the y-axis, this is million floating point operations per second, is calculated as nq divided by the time to compute the matrix multiplication. That's how speed is calculated. So the application that I've chosen is entirely problem size dependent. They're not data dependent. Okay. As you can see, the profiles are smooth for let's call it single core applications which run on single core CPUs. Okay, It's important to see that this profile is not just a profile, it's a performance model you're seeing here. Okay? Now that's what I mentioned, highlighted here. This is a performance model of the application, and this is a fundamental building block for data partitioning algorithms for homogeneous clusters or heterogeneous clusters. So a smooth profile is easy to build. Okay, a smooth profile is easy to build, and load balancing algorithms here have, because of the nice properties of this profile, load balancing algorithms find optimal solutions, in the sense optimal workflow distributions. Okay, I'm showing you here the average dynamic power of the same application against problem size, dynamic energy of the same application against problem size. Dynamic energy is almost linear, you know, which is, this is a perfect thing you can ask for. Okay, now this is the situation before the multicores happened. Okay, just think of it that way. It's a very nice situation to be in, and like I said, power profile is smooth, energy profile is almost linear, and the difference is the dynamic power and dynamic energy is the power and energy that is consumed by the application alone. Okay, we have just removed everything else, the base power and the base energy, from the total energy to get these two things. And they are measured using WhatsApp pro meters, which are connected to the node. We haven't relied on software models because we didn't find an accurate model to use to actually build these graphs here. Okay, so as you can see, these smooth and linear models, which prior to advent of multicores are easier to construct, and we have load balancing algorithms which take these models as input and can give you optimal workload distributions to use in your partitioning algorithms, use in your handle applications. Okay, now we are in right now, basically, and since we have multicores which have happened, I want you to visualize this picture in a way that I'm increasing the number of cores in my application. Okay, this is a multi-threaded open DGM application, matrix multiplication application. I'm increasing the number of threads. I start with one, I then use two threads, four threads, eight threads, 16 threads, 24 threads. I want you to visualize it this way. 2005, we had two cores. 2007, we had four cores. 2009, we had eight cores. 12 cores, 16 cores, now we have 24 cores. And see what's happening to the profile. Okay, there are remarkable variations in the profile. In the performance model, let's look at it as a performance model. You can see the performance model has become pretty complex, and there are dramatic variations in the profile. Okay? So if you give this profile to a load balancing algorithm, it'll go nuts. You know, you'll probably throw some garbage out to give this profile to a state-of-the-art load balancing algorithm. So each point here actually is determined very carefully. It's not like a single run. Statistically, you run it until your statistical confidence is achieved. So these are reproducible variations. These are not stochastic variations.
Sorry, excuse me. Can I ask a quick question? Is there any significance about what happened at 2.5? Was this an anomaly?
No, it's not anomaly. This is reproducible. You know, so the thing about this is it's very hard, unless you're an expert in this application, it's really hard to find out where these variations are coming from. But these are happening, actually.
Yeah.
You know, so as a group, we are not application experts in the sense that you know, we work with highly optimized applications like open class. We take it and then sort of build it up. So in this case, probably we have to go back to OpenBlast DGM and show them the profile and see what's happening actually. You know, and there are too many factors because the chips are so complex. There are too many factors we would feel. So here we would say that the last level cache is probably the culprit. You know,
okay, thanks.
Because it's a multi-threaded application, a lot of threads. They are sort of being very unproductive here. As you can see, it's quite remarkable for 24 threads. See, I haven't used 48 here. I mean, with hyper-threading on. 48 would have been much more dramatic here. So this is a full performance function. When I say full performance function, I've used all the memory in the node to build this function. And each point in this function is actually very carefully obtained. As you can see, there's significant variations when all the cores are used. Width of the variations is 17%. Okay, and previously it used to be 2%, 3%, which is like inherent noise in the single core era. Okay, now you have these variations, 17%. An algorithm can actually plug into these variations and can give you, can actually tap into these variations. And if it can decide a heterogeneous workload distribution, it can give you 70% benefit over and above an optimized load balancing algorithm. That's why I'm focusing on the width of the variations here. Okay, so this is a dynamic power. It's not important. We don't rely too much on dynamic power. We just showed these plots. What we are more interested in is the performance and the energy. Okay, dynamic power is a, this is an average dynamic power, actually. So again, you can see a lot of variations as you increase the number of threads. Say matrix multiplication application. I'll come to, you may ask why you're using OpenBLAST. Okay, I'll come to the, because it's Intel platform. We've done with Intel MKL as well. And Intel MKL has problems also. So this is dynamic energy as the number of threads are varied. Okay, now the energy reduces, which is what you see with multi-threading. But as you can see, remarkably for T is equal to two threads itself, the variations start. You know, and when you go to T16, which is 16 threads in your application, and T24, there's not much to choose between them. Okay, and T24 has a lot of variations. So these are the full dynamic power and dynamic energy profiles. You know, as you can see, the dynamic energy profiles, the width is increasing, which suggests that it's not stochastic. In stochastic variations, as you experiment with bigger and bigger problem sizes, the variations should reduce. Okay, but because these are deterministic noise, or what you call deterministic variations, you can see the width increasing with problem size. And the maximum width of variations in energy profile is almost 70%, you know, for this application. Okay, now we come to Intel MKL. Okay, and you might say Intel MKL is a highly optimized native version on this platform. It shouldn't show you any, it should be very smooth. It's not actually, you know, Intel MKL, there are variations, but you can see the spectacular drops in specific problem sizes. Okay, and these apply at very specified intervals. And at these points, what's essentially happening is the threads are throwing each other's data out. Okay, trying to get their work done, you know. So this you can observe right now. Taken Haswell and run Intel MKL DGM for let's say problem size, you start 64, 128, 192, and that's what the G64 means. When you run G72, everything is okay. Okay, now you have to figure that out, right? Okay, now with G72, if I run in the sense that I use a step size of 72, I'll be fine. But the thing problem is, okay, now you can, if I have problem size which is a multiple of 64, I have to run for a problem size which is a multiple of 72 and use it for 64. That requires modifications to my code, some memory remanagement, and all that reorganization. But what I wanted to show you is this has never been seen before. You know, the profiles were really smooth before, but because of this complex, tighter integration, the profiles have changed dramatically. Now this is for Fourier transform. So I wanted to show you in-depth matrix multiplication. So now I'll sort of cover all the profiles for Fourier transform. Fourier transform is even more dramatic. The width of variations, I'm talking about the average width of variations here is 60%, okay? And the maximum width of variations in energy profile is 125%. So typically an algorithm can tap into these variations, create a workload distribution which is heterogeneous, and potentially can have 125% savings in energy. We can tap into these variations. Okay, and so this is a two-dimensional discrete Fourier transform of N to N. We're talking about dense applications here. So this is Intel MKL on, now we have, I've shown you for multi-cores. This is for many-core accelerators. So this is Intel MKL DGEM on Intel Xeon Phis accelerator 2130P, I think it's 3120P. It's quite an old accelerator, 57 cores. Now we are Knight's Landing, 72 cores. So as you can see here, a lot of variations. The width, there's quite a width that you can tap into here. So it's a small card, 6 GB card. So we have written an out-of-core version to actually create a full profile here. As you can see, that there are quite drastic variations between problem size 12,000 and 35,000 width of 25%. Okay, so think of these profiles as not just profiles, these are models actually. These are performance models or energy models that are actually key inputs to your data partitioning algorithms. Okay, so this is Intel Inkale on the latest, I think it's not Knight's Landing, it's Knight's Corner, 60 cores. It's okay, I think it's smooth. but the problem is these spectacular drops again. Why these drops are happening? Actually, we are not the experts. We have to go to Intel and ask them. We have Intel experts here. So they probably would understand these drops. But the good news here is at least the performance and energy profiles are correlated, in the sense that when these performance drops happen, these energy spikes also happen. Because they are correlated, in the sense 100% correlated, the bi-objective problem of performance and energy becomes easier. If they're not correlated, you're in trouble, in the sense that it becomes a very tough problem to solve. Okay? Right, GPUs, good news. GPUs is pretty good. Very smooth profiles. Somehow, I feel GPU architectures are generally contention free. They've avoided this contention in their architecture. Maybe this is an inherent a characteristic of a throughput-oriented architecture compared to a latency-oriented architecture. And, but you can see a spectacular drop, but that's out of core. You're moving from in-core to out-of-core version there. But the rest is like quite smooth. So if you give this to a load-balancing algorithm, and the load-balancing algorithm will be very happy. It will give you an optimal solution. When I mean optimal solution, it will give you an optimal workload distribution to use in homogeneous clusters. Okay, now I've shown you these kernels, Fourier transform and matrix multiplication. You might say that those are very basic kernels. Is this true for a real life application? Now we have real life application here. This is MP data. this is the weather forecasting application. The details are here. It's a multi-dimensional positive definite advection transport algorithm. I don't know what it is, but it might make sense for CFD exports. It's a core component of an OILOG solver. It's a computational fluid dynamics solver, which is used for numerical weather prediction simulation of urban flows. So this is a real-life production application, and this is the profile. Okay, it used to be very smooth, but right now this is a profile of the application. There are drops. Really significant drops in performance. Okay, so it just shows you how this speed function is built. So what they do is they take Intel Manycore platform. They have they use four themes and they create this profile. These four profiles and they take an average of all these profiles. Okay, so I just want to show you an idea of load imbalancing solution here. What you can do is, if you're trying to solve a problem size 120, you pick 2 points from the neighborhood. You have 2 points in the neighborhood, 112 and 128, which have better performance. So you're solving a problem size of 2 into 120, you can have a heterogeneous workload distribution of 112 plus 128. And the maximum of their execution times would be better than the problem size 2 into 120. So we have here what is known as a load imbalancing solution, a workload distribution that you can use to optimize your applications. Okay, so I'll skip this slide. This is explaining the variations, and it's sort of saying that they're very complex in the sense that there are several local optima, they're non-linear, non-convex, they're like, to be honest, we tried using optimization solvers and we didn't find any to actually give optimal solutions for this scenario. So we had to come up with our own algorithms to actually get the workload distribution given this model as an input. Okay, so there are three approaches to actually, given such a profile, there are three approaches to optimize your application. One is to smoothen the profiles, and this even the experts can't do. Okay, forget like, you know, a team like that which actually works at a high level, even experts are not able to do these variations. Then you can solve a bigger problem size and use it for smaller problem size, but require source code modifications and memory rearrangement. Parallel computing solutions are very portable, and this is what we sort of designed, a parallel computing solution which gives you a heterogeneous workload distribution. And this is a load imbalancing distribution. Okay, it's not the optimal solution does not load balance an application. It load imbalances an application. Okay, so I sort of come to the end of the talk. I'm not going into the details of the algorithms. What the algorithms do is, given a profile and you have P identical processors, it picks P points to maximize the performance and minimize the energy distribution. And the details of the algorithms you can find in this paper. And software is also there in the Git repository in UCD. So this is the conclusion. You have complex chips with tighter integration, then you have serious challenges for model and algorithm developers. So right now you are entering an era of load imbalancing algorithms. Okay, and you've gone past the load balancing algorithms now. That's it. So this is ongoing research work at the laboratory. We're trying to extend this, use these two energy and performance profiles to study bioobjective optimization. And we're trying to parallelize this algorithm because sequential ones have limitations in terms of memory, time complexity. We're trying to extend this for heterogeneous clusters. So thank you, and keep taking patience.